Come on.
Can we'll move on to our next speaker. And so I've got the great pleasure of introducing you to Mark Kramer. Mark is a senior lecturer within the Physical Activity, Sport and Recreation Unit at Northwest University in South Africa. His research tends to focus on the intersection between biomechanics and exercise physiology in the domains of both sports science and biokinetics. And Mark's talk is entitled Using Open Source Software for Quantitative Kinematic Analysis. So over to you, Mark.
Thank you, Yumna. I really appreciate the introduction. Let me just figure out how to share the screen quickly. Okay, perfect. So I think my talk is going to dovetail quite nicely with the video that you guys just saw. So in a South African context, we've got a variety of students with a variety of mathematical and physics abilities. Some more, some less. So in order to cater for students of all levels of backgrounds, we give them quite a lot of support material. And that includes things like textbooks, quite detailed lab manuals that give them sample problems to work through, as well as solutions to those types of problems, research articles, various practicals, tests at regular intervals, quite a detailed course guide that tells them exactly what they need to read and prepare for in their lecture content as they get exposure to some of the theoretical background, and then a whole bunch of instructional support videos to allow students to cover some of the content at their own pace. What also complicates things a little bit for us is the fact that we have students in our program that have a variety of backgrounds or specializations. So we have biokineticists that focus a little bit more on rehabilitation, and sports scientists that tend to focus more on performance enhancement. So our lecture content, at least, yes.
Sorry, just to stop you, you're in your presentation view. So we can see your next slide and your notes. If you can go into.
So like I was saying, we have biokineticists and sports scientists. So to try and cover that content for both of them, we have a middle ground between performance and injury so that we speak to both sets of students. Now, traditionally, we have a lecture classroom environment where we cover the content. But since 2016, we were forced to go online. There were quite a few student protests throughout the country. And luckily, this happened because of the fact that it has prepared us much better for what happens in 2020. To make the online format a lot more successful, especially when it comes to delivering practical work, students often require access to other computers, laptops, or smartphones. Flash drive for us to distribute the content, as well as freely available software. So in the previous video, you guys saw the Kinovia, for example, and Tracker. I'm going to add to that by showing some simulation software that we created in Excel. So the follow-up question to that usually is, do students require internet in order to do these types of practical assignments? And we've tried to design it in such a way that access to the internet is not a prerequisite, because internet in South Africa is often quite expensive. And so students only have limited resources or limited access to internet. So one of the ones that I want to just cover first is the Tracker video analysis and modeling tool. It was mentioned in the previous video, but they didn't go into too much detail. The way in which we set up practicals using this type of a freely available tool, especially for video analysis, we have one of two options. Either we pre-record the data ourselves, which is obviously quite labor intensive. There's a lot of thinking that has to go into the video setup, as you saw in the previous video. The alternative is that students can use their own smartphones in order to capture the video. In either or option, we provide a lot of support documents and instructional videos for students to show them exactly how to set everything up. So essentially the video that you guys just saw, we give that kind of material to the students. Again, we distribute it via flash drive, so all of the content is saved in the flash drive. We distribute that to students who usually work in group for these assignments. And that means that we have, say, 20 or 30 flash drives that we then distribute to the students to give them the content that they need. That then goes on to data analysis. So how do they derive useful information once the videos have been digitized? And again, there we provide a lot of support documentation and instructional videos, as well as manuals that guide students through how to assess and analyze graphs, how to interpret the data, how to extract useful data, and then use that information ultimately to write a report on that analysis. And the complexity of the analysis can scale up or scale down. So we lecture to students from second year all the way to honors. So that the level of difficulty tends to scale up and ramp up quite quickly. But again, the support material is there. The only online portion that is required is the submission of the assignment at the end. So that's the only time that a student would need to access the internet and then submit the assignment electronically so that it can be graded. So some of the positives of using this type of an approach is that there's really good flexibility. So there's many types of movements that can be analyzed. There's loads of applications. So the students would have learned all of the theoretical components before, and then they can actually see how the theory transpires into something that they can actually tangibly measure. It also exposes students to a variety of calculations and the real life application of some of those calculations. In theory, it often becomes quite abstract, but once they actually see it in action, it tends to make sense for a lot of them quite quickly. And obviously the great bonus is that it's freely available. What's also really nice with the tracker software is that it can be downloaded on a flash drive and distributed. So students don't have to download it via the internet at home. If you put it on a flash drive, you give it to them, they can just use it straight away from the flash drive, which is really great. Some of the less positive aspects is it's usually limited to only kinematic analyses, although you can go the kinetic route. It just depends on what you know as the lecturer and what you can essentially unpack using this type of a software. And often it's also just limited to two-dimensional analyses, as we saw previously. So we've created some simulations for our students just using Excel. I'll show you in the next slide exactly what that looks like. Essentially, the setup is exactly the same. So we can either pre-record videos or have students record their own videos with the instructions that need to be followed. The key here is then the digitization process of the video would happen within the simulation software. Again, there's data that needs to be analyzed, graphs that need to be interpreted, a report that needs to be written up, and the submission that needs to be done online. What's really nice with Excel is everyone has access to Excel. That's freely available. So once they have access to the template, they can go ahead with the digitization of the videos and then start to unpack it from there. The positives of this type of an approach, again, is it has loads of application. So again, you can unpack any number of movements and really get into depth with the biomechanical applications of the theory and seeing it in action. It tends to build really good intuition. So like I said, in the lecture environment, students often get bogged down with the theory, but to really see how some of the graphs that they see in textbooks tend to apply in the real life situation once they actually assess and analyze a movement is really useful. Again, it exposes students to graphical analyses. And in this case, because of how we digitize everything, there's great opportunity for some kinetics in the analysis. Some of the less positive aspect is there's a little bit less flexibility. So you have to create a template essentially for each movement that you want to digitize. So the number of movements that you can analyze is then limited to the number of templates that you have created. So we've got stuff for running, for jumping, and so on, and rowing, as you can see in the picture. But again, how many templates you have available is completely up to you. It's typically limited also to slower movements because the digitization process can be quite labor intensive. We don't want to overburden students with something that's quite laborious. The point of a simulation is really to build intuition. So slower movements that happen in short periods of time are plenty. And again, it's limited to two-dimensional motion. So just to show you what that looks like, essentially. So on the screen, you have a student that has digitized a standing broad jump. So you can see here that the video has been digitized into the relevant sections. They can go through it on a frame-by-frame basis. The simulation would have recreated the center of mass. And then in the middle graphs, the students can unpack any number of variables. So if they want to measure range of motion of the shoulder, of the elbow, of the hip or the knee, they want to look at angular velocity or angular acceleration, anything related to the center of mass, ground reaction forces, so on and so forth. Again, they can play around with it in their own time and they can really unpack that. So we just provide guided learning opportunities, and the information that they then get from that is based on their ability to extract the data from the simulation. What's also really great that we try and do is to speak to both sets of students in the class. So irrespective of what their specialization tends to be, when it comes to sports scientists, we try to do something that's a little bit more performance based. And when it comes to the biokineticists, we try and do something that's a little bit more clinical. Both of these tend to run at the same time. So it's a little bit more labor intensive for the lecturer, but it allows really good opportunities for students to engage in their respective disciplines. So just some examples using either the tracker or the simulation side of things that we've done with sports scientists includes stuff like sprint starts, where they look at joint kinematics over the first few steps. We've looked at water polo, where we investigate things like the shoulder rotation angles, as well as water clearance, how high they come up, and look at the differences between fatigue and non-fatigue in terms of goal shooting accuracy. Modeling something like the 40-meter sprint velocity gives students plenty of opportunity to practice some of those principles. From the more clinical side of things, some aspects that we tend to look at are effects of joint position on rotation velocity, range of motion and path length, effect of throwing mass on shoulder rotation. So if an individual has different loaded balls, for example, how does it affect the shoulder rotation? Things like external knee or hip torque, what are the effects of that, or how is that different between front and back squats? So again, really key biomechanical aspects, but just applied slightly differently depending on the context. So the biggest challenge often in the remote format is to really find novel ways to apply the theory in practical settings. So another aspect that we've done is through the creation of experiential learning mini assignments. So there's so much theoretical content in the semester that the students have to cover. So to keep them engaged in the biomechanical aspects, but from a practical side of things, these mini assignments are something that we release on a week by week basis. And it's simple things. It's, you know, assess how long it takes you to cover a given distance, how fast on average were you running over that distance, how high can you jump, or what are some of the knee joint angles as you land from a jump, and so on and so forth. So stuff that's simple enough to do in the privacy of your own home, with simple technologies, but just to continuously keep you engaged in some of the theoretical content, but in a more applied setting. What then happens with these mini assignments is on a weekly basis, students would have to log that on something like Google Sheets, as you've heard it before. The only thing that we've done to make it different is that we don't count it for marks. So the application there, or there's a limitation there sometimes in terms of student engagement, because as soon as it's not for marks, we often find that students don't necessarily do it. But it's just, again, for those students that want the experiential learning side of things. So the question then often is biomechanics just video analysis and simulation? The answer to that is definitely not. There's lots of different things that they can do. I think in most university environments, we have access to a lot of technology. So there's things like freely available Excel templates where students can assess and analyze force velocity profiles, for example, of resisted jumping, force velocity power profiles of sprinting, calculations of jump height just using simple applications, foot scan data where they investigate maybe wearing shoes or going barefoot or walking and running. Again, it just depends on what you have available and the guided learning that you expose students to. In a nutshell, that's it from my side. Thank you very much. If you have any questions or queries, my contact details are also available in the bottom right-hand corner of the screen. So I'd be more than happy to answer those questions.